partnership between the Synovus Energy Hub and the Lloydminster and District Co-op was cemented on Friday. In an effort to get more funding for the highly anticipated arena, the city has partnered with the co-op. The announce was made before the women's Lakeland Rustlers faced off against the St. Trojans.
A commitment to for 10 years to gain the naming rights for $300,000, and we'll have that naming rights on the community side of the arena. So it'll be the co-op community arena.
On top of naming rights for the new community rink, it's planned to be the new home for the Lakeland Rustlers hockey team.
Opportunity, we have the, you know, not many communities get to say they have a college plus, you know, the level of sports that are active in our community, and this is one of the ways I think we can raise their profile and again enhance the look of the city and say, I want to go to school there, I want to go to college in Lakeland College, and it just adds to, I think, the value of what our city has to offer.
The project's total cost sits at $101 million. Inclusion Alberta talked to the Rotary Club of Lloydminster this morning as they shared the biggest struggles they face. Wendy McDonald, the COO of Inclusion Alberta, states that the Rotary Club helps out through the Rotary Employment Partnership Program, helping all types of people with intellectual disabilities.
So the role of Rotary is to be what the service disability service sector would call job developers. So Rotary is an organization that is well-networked, has a presence in community, demonstrates leadership in the communities where Rotary clubs exist. And so the role of Rotary is to help open the doors for potential employment for people with intellectual disabilities.
Since the program started in 2001, McDonald and the rest of Inclusion Alberta have helped out the community in more ways than one.
Since the inception of the partnership in Lloydminster, 96 jobs created in this community for people with intellectual disabilities.
McDonald has been a part of Rotary for the past 34 years and states it's a big reason why she joined Inclusion Alberta, because of this program that helps so many. St. Mary Elementary and the Catholic School Board acknowledged a teacher this morning for her service by surprising her with an award. Kayla Wakelin was given the Catholic Excellence Award by the staff of the school. Wakelin says that she did not expect to get the award, but she's delighted to accept it.
I just felt honored. I wanted to cry. I'm probably going to cry now. And just like blessed that I get to do this every day and share God's love with the kids and help them realize how important they are as children of Christ. So.
The kindergarten teacher also gave some advice and a tip to future and current teachers.
That we do it for the kids and make sure that you have some kind of outlet outside of school. So like for me, it's music and I play a lot of hockey, probably more than most people. So being able to do something outside of school that gives you a little bit of an outlet so that you can still enjoy your life, even with all of the things that come with being a teacher outside of work as well. So.
Wakelin has been teaching in the school for 5 years. And now it is time for this week's edition of Retrospect. Here's our Callum Hawker.
This week in Retrospect, we take it back to January of 1995 as the Minor Hockey Association prepares for the season final tournament.
We have 16 teams participating. Teams are coming from in Saskatchewan and all over Saskatchewan and Alberta, and it's going to be a good one. I think the competition is going to be comparable to the last few years. We always pride ourselves in having good competition and a high quality tournament.
With the final tournament set to go, all that remains for the Minor Hockey Association will be playoffs and provincials. And so far, it's been a good year for the Volunteer Association.
It's been an excellent year. All the teams, most of the teams are participating in leagues, and they're all doing very well, and things have gone very smoothly. I've had good people running in my directors and coaches, and they've handled things quite well.
One of the reasons for the smooth sailing this year has been the addition of a third artificial ice surface. Late last fall, the Archie Miller was converted over from natural ice.
It's made our ice consistent, where in prior years when we had a warm spell, then the bigger guys wouldn't get on the ice and they missed practice. And this year, throughout the whole system, the little guys got their share, and we're looking forward to it carrying through the end of March and giving everybody a good shot of ice.
Another major headache the association did not have to deal with this year was the insurance issue. Now into its second year, no rate increases, but meetings later this year could change all that.
There are some meetings coming up with CHA, and they intimate to me that they're probably going to continue an insurance program, and we don't know what the rate is going to be, but hopefully they don't raise it, because it's a major factor.
With a long hockey season now into the home stretch, there's still no talk of stepping down just yet. Benning says that's too early to comment on, but you've got to think that there will be at least one more year at the helm for the president. Keith Snellgrove, NewsHour Sports.
And in 1999, we take a look back on the gun laws that were implemented, stating that all firearms need to be registered with the government.
About 150 people listened as Lufa took aim on the new federal gun law.
It's people control law, it's not just firearms law.
By 2003, all gun owners must register their firearms with the government. Lufa members don't agree with the law and say they plan to defy it.
Lufa wants to be there to tell the Supreme Court justices that there's hundreds of thousands of law-abiding Canadians that will not obey this law, and therefore it must be a bad law.
West Midwest residents walked through these doors to hear Lufa's four-pronged plan to present the government with a list of Canadians willing to stand up and defy the law, to achieve intervener status, to attack MPs at their riding level, and ultimately, if necessary, plug the legal system by going to jail, all designed to protect the freedom of Canadians.
Lufa looks for real democracy, something that we don't have in this country right now. The federal government has a total disregard for the common people. And what we're doing is we're trying to rally the silent majority.
They also seriously doubt the law will succeed in reducing crime.
If I thought that the law, as it's written, would reduce crime, I would be the first one to register my firearms. But there is no statistical analysis, there is no substantiation put forth by the government, or for that matter anywhere else in the world, that proves that this type of registration will reduce crime.
Any machinist can turn out a gun in 20 minutes that would shoot one shell for murder or to hurt anybody. You can go into the internet anytime and it'll tell you exactly how to make a gun. You don't have to, if you're going to use it to commit a crime, you're not going to have it for shooting 50 rounds anyway. You want to use it for one or two shots and that's it. Anybody that can read can build a gun.
Why should it work now? Never worked before. I mean, it didn't hurt nobody before. We had guns here for 400 years.
The government is not realistically going to put 30,000 people in jail. They can't do it. It's impossible. Their jails would be so crammed to the rafters and over a petty crime, you know, that it wouldn't work.
Lufa will continue to tour rallying support against the law. A meeting will be held in Lloydminster February 3rd. In Ardmore, Shannon Fagan, NewsHour.
And that's all we have for this week in Retrospect.
Retrospect is brought to you by Webb's Machinery. Find New Holland products at Webb's Machinery, your dealer in Vermilion, Vegreville, Lamont, Wainwright, St. Paul, and Consulate.
Abby St. John joins me now with the weather. And Abby, boy, did we ever get it dumping.
Yes, we did all yesterday pretty much. Started in the morning and then I think it just didn't stop until it was a giant pile out. And you know, I'm not thrilled. I'm not thrilled by the amount that I had to brush off. Plus it's all covering ice as well that we had. And I even remember shaking my head a little bit this morning and being like, it's not that cold out. Why is there still snow on the ground? Even though, you know, still below zero, it still didn't feel that cold today. It felt quite nice, actually, despite there being a ton of snow to get through, which is always a nice thing. You know, I'd rather it be a little bit warmer and trudge through it than it being freezing and having to still trudge through it. We're sitting at -7 here. We've had an overcast day all day today. It feels closer to -12 with that wind chill, so at least we're in the lower teens. or lower double digit numbers rather, and the winds are only at 11 kilometers per hour. And then current temperatures across the region, -7 in Provost, Wainwright, Marwain, St. Paul, Vegreville and Edmonton, -6 in Vermilion and Bonnyville, and -5 in Cold Lake and Lac La Biche. And on the Saskatchewan side, -7 out in Isle of Crosse and St. Walburg, -4 in Pearsland and Green Lake, -6 in Maidstone and -5 in Meadow Lake, Macklin and in North Battleford. Now overnight tonight in North Battleford will drop down to -7, lower clouds in the sky, winds at 9 kilometers per hour, and there's not a huge chance of precipitation, but there's about a 25% chance that there could be some snowfall. And then tomorrow, cloudy conditions as well as expected, a high of -3, and the winds will start to pick up to about 15 kilometers per hour. Overnight tonight in Cold Lake will drop down to -11, considerably cloudy, so it's definitely going to be overcast, and there's about a 68% chance of the occasional snow or flurries throughout out the evening. That will be mostly later on in the evening, and it's about predicted about 1 centimeter to accumulate of snow, 13 kilometer per hour winds. And then tomorrow, daytime high of -7, lower clouds as well, cloudy condition, 15 kilometer per hour winds as well. Overnight tonight here in Lloydminster will drop down to -10. We will also remain overcast today with the clouds a little bit lower, but the wind will slow down just a tad to 9 kilometers per hour. And then tomorrow to break down the day, expect another overcast day out, -10 around 6 a.m., 9 kilometer per hour winds. And then it picks up to 15 kilometers by noon. We'll sit at -6 and for the rest of the evening. It may jump up and down as the evening goes on, but it will remain around -6 with 15 kilometer per hour winds throughout the majority of the day. And then over the next 3 days, we are expected very cloudy days over the next little while, with a high of -5 and a low of -9 for tomorrow. And then on Wednesday, it will be cloudy with a high of -2 and a low of -6. And on Thursday, there is a 96% chance of about 5 to 10 centimeters of snow accumulating, with a high of -3 and a low of -8. That is a first look at your evening weather forecast. I'll have more overnight temperatures later on in the show.
Heavy snowfall over the last day has likely been welcomed by many farmers across the region who would appreciate a few more heavy snowfalls. Our Thomas Wildman has more in this report.
Today I'm joined by Mackenzie Ladoon, a crop extension specialist for the government of Saskatchewan, and she is here today to talk about the low moisture that we have been seeing throughout this winter and how it is going to be affecting crop producers as well as livestock producers in Saskatchewan. And so thank you so much for being with me today, Mackenzie.
Thank you so much for having me, Thomas.
And so Mackenzie, how important is snow and upcoming moisture throughout the winter and spring for the upcoming growing season this summer for crop producers and livestock producers as well?
Well, first things first, it's hard to predict what's going to happen in the next couple of months. So there's always fingers crossed that we're going to get some more snow or some rain coming up in the spring. So there's always the hope that we could have some early storms coming through this growing season. But as you said, moisture is incredibly important to both grain producers and also ranchers and cattlemen. What that moisture does is essentially, for our grain producers, that it makes sure that those seeds in the ground have enough moisture so that they can germinate and establish a good rooting system so that they can tap further into further moisture. The same goes for our pasture, and that's really important to our cattlemen as well. It's those pastures, they need that moisture to really start that green up process and really rejuvenate the plants that have been kind of gone dormant over the winter. The other thing that's really important about the lack of snow right now is there's lack of insulation for our fall seeded cereals. So our fall rye and winter wheat need that snow and insulation to make sure that they're also set for up for success for the coming summer. But as I said, it's only January or February right now, and it's really hard to tell what's going to happen in the next couple of months.
And so you mentioned winter wheat and other crops that need the cold weather and snow to help them germinate and replenish. Are there any other major factors that are affected with this warm weather that we're experiencing right now?
Absolutely. So our fall seeded cereals do require a nice snow layer to keep them dormant and keep them vernalizing throughout the winter. So that really helps them in their phenological processes and establishing them on the right path for this coming season. So they do need a little bit of snow to keep them isolated. Again, the different crops and the different amounts of snow that they need does vary, but you do need some snow to keep those crops ready up and set for the summer.
And finally, Mackenzie, is there any other major benefits for a good snow and a lot of moisture for the upcoming growing season?
Absolutely. Well, grasshoppers are always a really important point right now, considering the last growing season. And something about grasshoppers is that a lot of moisture in the spring can help produce mold in those eggs in the ground. So it can really decrease grasshopper numbers if we get more moisture. The other thing is that really cold temperatures have also been shown to knock back grasshopper numbers. So given that we just came out of a little bit of a cold snap, there is that added benefit. However, it all depends on where the grasshopper eggs are and if it's whether or not a significant enough period of time for that cold snap to really affect grasshopper numbers.
Thank you so much for all the information, Mackenzie, and we will definitely look forward to talking to you once again this summer for the upcoming growing season.
Thank you so much, Thomas. Happy to be here.
Now here are your agriculture prices for today. The Lloydminster Bobcats were looking to bounce back from a two-game losing streak and pack the Centennial Civic Center for a pivotal two home games this past weekend. Our Thomas Wildman has more with a wrap on the weekend.
The Lloydminster Bobcats started the weekend taking on the Olds Grizzlies and had a real barn buster with over 1,000 fans in attendance and grabbing a 5-2 victory. The next night, the Bobcats took on the Canmore Eagles for the fourth game of their season series, with the Bobcats winning 2 of 3. And the Bobcats were able to carry on their momentum from their previous win. Teague McAllister would start the scoring off 5 minutes into the first period. The Eagles would answer back with a shorthanded goal by Rhett Ducone late in the first, which would hold, leading to a 1-1 tie heading into the first intermission. The second period mirrored the first period, with Alessio Nardelli scoring early for the Bobcats and Tyler Lohman scoring late to tie it up once again with a 2-2 tie heading into the third period. Both teams tightened up defensively in the third, but finally the Bobcats broke through. Remy Spooner would score at 11:36 and would extend his scoring streak to 4 games. The Bobcats were able to continue to shut down the Eagles, and in the final 2 minutes, still trailing by a goal, the Eagles would pull their goalie and with a power play would have a 6-on-4 man advantage. The Bobcats were able to fend off the Eagles, and a pivotal shot block would set up Ishan Mitu to ice the game with the empty net goal, leading to the final score of 4-2 for the Bobcats' victory.
It was pretty good, but I mean, I think I gotta give credit to like the team there. I mean, we had like, I think it was like 2 minutes and 30 seconds. We had to play 6-on-4. Guys were selling out. It was like a team effort. Cabby made a good play to me, so it felt really good, and we got the win, so yeah.
The game against the Eagles also brought nearly 1,300 fans into the Centennial Civic Center, and the Bobcats were able to feed off the crowd to get the win.
Well, they were awesome. A lot of fans, a lot more than usual, and we just really, really enjoyed the support from our community and really appreciate it and hope we put on a good show.
The Bobcats will look to build on this two-game winning streak when they head on the road to take on the Camrose Kodiaks. Thomas Wildman, Primetime, local news.
In other AJHL news, the final decision has now come for the 5 defecting AJHL teams that are heading to the BCHL. The BCHL, alongside the 5 defecting teams, have released their plans for the rest of the season, which will have the 5 teams play against each other and then eventually play the BCHL champ. The AJHL then responded with their own news release, saying that now there is no path for them to return to the AJHL. With all these decisions, a few question marks still remain, but for the Bobcats, the focus will be to continue playing their best and be ready for whatever comes next.
With the information that I have, we're just, we're focused on our next game. And, I think that you might see some slight changes to the schedule, but I know the league's excited to move forward. Our guys are excited to move forward. And it's just next game up mentality right now for us.
The five defecting teams have been removed from the standings on the AJHL website, and decisions on playoff format and possible makeup games are expected within the coming weeks. Bud Miller Park was a runner's paradise as the Lloydminster Runners Club held their second annual Winter Runderland. Our Ben Lowon has more.
The second Winter Runderland took place at Bud Miller Park. Participants could choose to run either the 5 or 10K. Last year, over 70 runners braved the minus 37 temperatures to race. This year, there were over 100. Project manager Chris Bogue is happy to see the community turnout no matter the season.
Absolutely, yeah. Lloydminster running community is already a good, strong community on its own, but people like to challenge themselves through the winter activities as well.
Men, women, and dogs came out to run the course, and there were plenty of friends and family to help cheer them on. Everyone was out here for different reasons, but the runners understand how the community has benefited everyone within it.
It's nice to meet other people who are into running and have fun with you.
It's just a nice, easy group to be with. It's very welcoming.
The Lloydminster running community is one of the most inclusive groups that I've ever been in.
The top three finishers in each race received a medal and a plaque. 15-year-old Alex Giesbrecht finished second place in the men's 5K. Despite the cold weather, he had a fun time out on the course.
It was good. It was really nice, but the course was a little slippery.
Giesbrecht also had some strategies to deal with the slippery corners.
Yeah, I just kind of slowed down a lot, took very careful steps, and just made sure not to go too fast because then you'll slip out.
The next event the club is hosting is the Titanium Half Marathon June 9th. For Primetime Local News, I'm Ben Lowon.
Now time to take a look at all of those cute pet pictures you've been sending in to us for our Pets of the Day.
We want to see your pets. Send photos of your pet and their name and have them featured on Pet of the Day.
Constable Kelsey Davidge today with the Lloydminster RCMP with regard to body-worn cameras and some field testing that's going to be happening in our region. Can you tell me more about that, Kelsey?
We'll be field testing body-worn cameras as a new digital evidence management system. Body-worn cameras will help increase the trust between police and the communities we serve. This is an unbiased, objective way to capture interactions between police, the public, and everyone, really.
Are there any privacy concerns with regard to a person having an interaction with the RCMP wearing a body-worn camera?
If it's within the public, and if it's to create an unbiased account of what happened, that would be, why wouldn't someone want that recorded?
So can you tell me, how will the field testing work?
Yeah, so starting this month, frontline members within Grand Prairie, Alberta, St. Paul, and Parkland County will begin field testing these body-worn cameras. This field test will continue for the next 8 to 10 weeks. Officers, you'll see them wearing cameras within the middle of their chest, and the public will know when it's recording as a red light will be visible within that camera. This field test represents the final stages of procurement process that will be used to inform the rollout of those body-worn cameras within RCMP across the county. Should this contractor demonstrate the ability to meet all of our requirements during these field tests. They will be confirmed as the provider for those body-worn cameras, and you'll see that being implemented across the country. This should take place between the next 12 to 18 months. And then you will see those cameras being worn on your everyday officer, and that will kind of be integrated into general line policing within the country.
How many total cameras are being tested across the country?
Areas that have been selected across Canada include Nova Scotia, Alberta, and Iqaluit up in Nunavut for the next 10 weeks. So 300 cameras worn between however many officers during that field testing period over the next 8 to 10 weeks across Canada.
Thank you for joining me today, Kelsey. I appreciate it.
Bye.
Furniture, set, and design supplied by Furniture Gallery, downtown Lloydminster.
Joining with us today is Dr. Alice Wainwright-Stewart, the president and CEO of Lakeland College. How are you doing?
Very good, Leo.
So let's go straight to the question. With the recent announcement of the federal government capping the intake of the international students, what do you think about that?
Well, I would say for Alberta, and probably Saskatchewan and Manitoba as well, that we haven't had as many international students. Now, there's different reasons for that. The biggest reason for Lakeland is that we've been very careful on making sure that we can be sustainable, as when we ask international students to come to Lakeland, we want to make sure that we have all of the pieces in place so that they can have a very good experience.
How many international students right now that is currently enrolled in Lakeland College?
Well, as of today, we have about 206 international students. And when we started down this journey of inviting international students to Lakeland, we looked at our region and said, at this point, we think about 300 will really be okay here at this region. We know that we are also looking at that because we're at 206 now. We do believe our region can take more. We are very aware of the job needs. And so Lakeland will do his part and make sure that we are providing housing, providing educational experiences for them, as well as making sure that they can have those part-time jobs that they need.
Will this changes or the announcement of the federal government going to affect Lakeland College in the future?
Well, right now we're waiting for two things for our government to do. One is to decide what are the caps for Alberta. We believe as a system-wide that our caps probably they may be more than some of the East because we don't have as many international students. So we have to wait for the government to make those decisions. But the other piece of that is that the government also has to provide attestation letters. And that's where making sure the immigrant piece of it, that's not part of the college, they have to have those letters before they come in. So yes, there is some caps, but we do know that for our international students, we want to make sure that they come over to Canada and have a very good experience. So they have identified a little higher expectation for the money that they have here. We too have had experiences with international students that may have not had as much money as they need to have a comfortable experience. So I think that will be okay. The special thing, again, is I think they're really trying to hone in on what are the needs of Alberta, get that, understand that before they make some decisions. So at this point, we're waiting for the government. We also do know there's a lot of information out there and there's a lot of maybe misinformation for international students. So international students that are watching this, remember, if you have been okayed before January 26th and you have all your papers in place, you don't need to worry. We as an institution will make sure that we provide as much detail as soon as the government comes out with our caps and with how they're going to issue attestation letters. We'll make sure that you have that information. So if you don't know or you're feeling uncomfortable, contact Lakeland and they'll provide you that information.
If further information or further details about the international student cap, what it will be the next step or what will be the next plan for Lakeland College?
Well, in terms of our plan is that we can go forward as we've planned. We have 206 students at present. We, in the last 5 years, have indicated that we know that our region can handle 300 students. So I think we're in a very good place. And I personally, as a member of the CICAN board, spoke with Minister Miller in the fall, and we talked about the rural areas a little different than what they're experiencing in the East. And I believe he's heard that, and I believe he's looked at Alberta, Saskatchewan, and Manitoba a little differently. And I think we're just awaiting, okay, what is that going to be? We do know nationwide that right now it's only Quebec that has the attestation letter. So everybody's trying to figure out how to go about and do that. So that will be the next step for us is, okay, once our students have their letters in place, it's business as usual for us.
Just a follow-up question for the people that wants to be an international student. What is the attestation letter?
That letter is a letter that is issued by the province. And without that letter, international students will not be able to get an okay to come to the institution. So it's very, very important. My understanding right now is that Alberta will be looking at how they're going to go about issuing those letters. We, as a post-secondary institution, have suggested making it as easy as possible, utilize one of the systems we already have. We have a MyCred system. We have a few systems that we've suggested that they maybe use those systems to make it easy for the students.
Well, thank you so much for giving us the time and your thoughts about this current announcement from the federal government.
You're very welcome. My pleasure. And always, we love our international students that come to Lakeland. They provide a variety of experiences and a great opportunity for learning for everyone. So we look forward to having our international students and our domestic students to learn alongside each other.
Once again, thank you so much for giving us the time.
You're very welcome.
A pair of Canadian music legends provided the emotional highlights at the Grammy Awards last night. Joni Mitchell made her first ever performance at the show with a stripped-down version of her classic, Both Sides Now. Such a performance seemed unimaginable after she was sidelined by a brain aneurysm in 2015. This is her 10th award. And then later on in the show, Celine Dion shocked the crowd, making one of her few public appearances to announce the winner of Album of the Year.
I love this, that two icons of Canadian music have come, you know, on this grand stage of an award show. I think it's awesome for Canada and awesome for them too, you know, going through health issues and being able to come back. I think it's awesome.
Yeah, it was great to see Celine looking so well. And that is all we have for you tonight. Have a great evening, and we'll talk to you tomorrow.